Queens Public Library continues to celebrate its 125th anniversary. Don't forget to browse our book list, share your QPL story, or take our library personality quiz. For more information, visit qpl125.org. For this year's celebration of Black History Month, Queens Public Library is focusing on Black health and wellness from a holistic lens. Join our virtual programs, check out our Black History book recommendations, and get a copy of our health journal to track your progress throughout the month of February. Learn more at queenslib.org/BHM2022. Celebrate Lunar New Year, the Year of the Tiger, with our virtual programs and book recommendations. Learn more at queenslib.org/LNY2022. We are also celebrating Library Lovers Month with our annual photo contest. Participate today by going to queenslib.org/LibraryLovers2022.
Hello and welcome to Queens Public Library's Wild in Queens. I'm Mark, the children's librarian at MassPeth Library. Today's program is one of many for the Hunters Point Environmental Education Center. Hope to see you at our next program on February 12th at 2 p.m. The plant micro, how microbes are intertwined with agriculture, food, and soil. Check the comments as well, as we'll be adding links for these events so you can set a reminder. These programs are made possible by the Newtown Creek Environmental Benefit Fund, administered by City Parks Foundation, and funded by the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. If you have any questions for our speaker, Jacob Mamie, please write them in the live chat. We'll have an audience Q&A at the end of this session. Without further ado, we are pleased to introduce Jacob Mamie, the Scout Coordinator at the Alley Pond Environmental Center, who will be giving us a peek into Alley Pond. Take it away, Jacob.
All right. Thank you very much, Mark. It's a pleasure to be talking to everybody today from Queens Public Library and on behalf of Alley Pond Environmental Center. So yes, my name is Jacob. I've been here for about 5 years now. I am the Scout Coordinator and an environmental educator with Alley Pond. And it's been a wonderful job. I'll actually go ahead and show you guys a bit about what my job is. We're going to go through what Alley Pond started out as, what the area, what the history of the area actually is. And then we're going to go into a bit about like our mission, how we go about teaching our programs, a little bit of insight into our programs. And this is going to end with a show and tell, basically, with a couple of our animals here. So we have a lot planned for an hour, so I'm going to go ahead and get started. So this is our 50th year of Alley Pond Environmental Center since its founding, which is super amazing, and it's something to celebrate, but it is a really impressive organization. We cater to many people, and we're going to go ahead and look at this PowerPoint I have ready to rumble. So this over here is our new building. We're going to actually be learning a bit more about what we can expect from our new center. It should be operational. We're hearing sometime like June, July, but Of course, because of how crazy things are with the pandemic, we're not 100% sure when it'll be open, but we can look forward to the beautiful new center that they've made on Northern Boulevard. So a bit about our mission. Alley Pond Environmental Center is a nonprofit, and we're dedicated to educating children and adults in the New York metropolitan area, protecting and preserving our park, open spaces, especially water bodies, and advocating for sustainable environmental policies and practices. That's our mission statement, and it couldn't be more true. We do everything around the environment here. All of our classes are just very environmental oriented. Visitors, young and old, can walk through our trails, and they can understand the connection between nature and our urban city. Pre-COVID, Alley Pond actually had over 60,000 visitors annually. We serve the school districts from the five boroughs, Nassau and Suffolk counties, and public school programs and public programs are available to visitors of all ages, from toddlers to seniors. So a bit about where we're located. We're located in Northeast Queens. We have a very interesting topography or landscape here at Alley Pond, where we have several different actual habitats and ecosystems in one very confined area, which is beautiful. And because it's so diverse, we have many different animals that live here. We have over 300 species of birds and other wildlife that can be found in our park. Our park is about 630 acres. And it comprises forests, meadows, ponds, fresh and saltwater marshes. So I actually included three different areas on the screen here. The first red circle, it highlights our old location closer to the mouth of Little Neck Bay, and that is Alley Creek. And then if you go further down, you'll see a brown tree. That's the Alley Pond Giant, which is the largest tree in New York City. It's a tulip tree that's very, very tall and is over 200 years old. And then the last circle is our current location at the southern end of the park. And this is a temporary modular unit that we've been in for the last 2 years. And honestly, it's very spacious and we do enjoy it. That's just for you guys to see what the layout is like in court in terms of streets. We're actually bisected by several different major highway systems. We have Northern Boulevard in the very top portion. We have I-495, the LIE, Long Island Expressway, right over here, going through the middle of our park. And then over here, we have Northern State Parkway, or Grand Central Parkway, which is in the southern end of the park. And all of this is, again, transected with the Cross Island Parkway running right through the middle. So this is a park that's really very urban. It's surrounded by city, and there are major roads going through it. So in order to understand the importance of this area, it's sort of good to go back in time a little bit more than we're used to. And as a geologist, or as somebody who studied geology, I can't claim to be a geologist. I don't have a PhD yet. But we actually have a really impressive area here that is reminiscent of the Ice Age. All of this area is basically made by the last glacial maximum, which was about 15,000 years ago. The ice started retreating. But when the ice got to Alley Pond Park, you can see a star where our nature center is located. The ice actually made it past where Alley Pond currently is. So that would be a glacier called the, it's a giant glacier. It starts with L. I can't remember exactly the name of it right now. But it was over 2,000 feet tall. So it would have covered the Freedom Tower in ice back at that time. And as you can see, as the glacier came down south, it sort of bulldozed a huge area of a hill we call a moraine. And that's a major landscape feature we have in our park, is this giant hill of compacted sediment from the glaciers. Ah, the Laurentide Ice Sheet. There we go. So it lies on a glacial moraine, which is basically a hill of bulldozed material from a glacier shoving everything underneath it. And this area is also sort of all over the place, is sort of pocked with different rocks that are very large. And we call these rocks erratics because they were dropped and they don't really look like they belong to the area. They're much bigger than the rest of the materials that we see here. So that's a remnant of the Ice Age as well. And we also have areas where, as the glacier broke apart, giant icebergs would sort of drop off and bury themselves partially into the sand. And as they melted away, the depression that they left would fill in with groundwater, and those would form lakes that we call kettle ponds. So at Alley Pond, we actually have several small kettle ponds that were made from the retreat of this glacier. And Shelter Rock, I included a little picture of this. This is the largest boulder on Long Island. It's estimated at 5 million pounds, and it was deposited here by the glacier. So that was something that definitely was here. And then we also even see to the left, there are elephants called mastodon and woolly mammoth, and even large beavers and other Ice Age animals made this area their home in the recent past. Oh, and that's one of our kettle ponds here. Actually, you can travel across many of our hiking trails and see our kettle ponds. This is one of our kettle ponds that is full of duckweed, which is a surface dwelling plant. Okay, so the historical background of our park, pre-1800s, it was used by the Matinecock Native Americans. They were very interested in using this particular area, especially the mouth of Little Neck Bay, for their fishing and for gathering clams. The quahog clam is a purple clam that they would use to manufacture beads called wampum that they would make into belts and almost use as a type of currency. And for early settlers, it was very important as a base for shell fishing. In 1929, the New York City finally acquired the area that would become our park. And this is actually a news clipping from that happening. More than 300 acres were purchased in that one movement there. And then Robert Moses began construction of the Cross Island Parkway throughout the park, and then the construction of the LIE shortly followed after. When all of this construction was going on, there was sort of a mentality that all of the debris left over from the construction could just be dumped into the neighboring wetland, because wetlands were at the time seen as wasteland. They weren't necessarily something that you needed. They were considered riddled with disease and mosquitoes. You don't need that, and it's better to develop it. But now we actually have a different change in consciousness. And this picture that I have in the background is actually of the construction of the Cross Island Parkway in the 1930s, which is pretty awesome. You actually see a horse and buggy carriage. Totally whack to see that. And then as time goes on, there's a change in the mindset of the environment, especially around the 1970s. There's the major environmental movement, there are the hippies, and they decide to recognize that wetlands are important as a barrier against storms, against storm surge, and they also are very important for native wildlife. So they served a very important ecological function. And by 1972, these two people here, this is High and Joan Rosner, they actually organized a grassroots environmental partnership with the Parks Department to create Alley Pond Environmental Center as an educational resource. And by the 1974, they created a reclamation project to rehabilitate all of the dumping ground. And you can actually still sometimes, they didn't do the, it's not that they didn't do the best job, they did a great job, but you can actually still see in our park old tires from concrete from the original filling in of the wetland, although most of it was restored by the 2000s. And by 1979, all that hard work to make Alley Pond Environmental Center was rewarded by designating it as a National Environmental Study Area. And today we have lots of projects that are done to remove invasive plants. During the Victorian era, people were bringing in all these beautiful plants, but they ended up being very invasive and spreading out all over our park. So we were ground zero for a bunch of nasty invasive species. Oh, and this duck is called a collared duck. It's beautiful. So we have lots of different environments within the park, mostly because of the groundwater that we have is sort of draining from the hills nearby. And the reason why we have such hills and valleys is because the glacier really carved it out, and meltwater beneath the glacier would sort of create these tunnel valleys, which sort of separates the north parts of Long Island, you know, East and West Egg, if you ever hear of the Great Gatsby, and that those are called tunnel valleys. So all of these hills are basically funneling water into lowlands like we have at Alley Pond. So the fresh water is draining into these natural areas. So there are a host of different ponds, lakes, and fresh and saltwater wetlands, tidal flats that create a very different, diverse ecosystem. Actually, Alley Pond is named after a pond that was filled in when they were making the highways. So this is Oakland Lake, which is one of the lakes in our park. And you can see we have some swans, some ducks. It's beautiful. These are some of our nature trails. This is one of the trails that sort of circles Oakland Lake as well in our park. This is toward the southern western edge of our park, I believe. And this is the northern area of our park where we have our tidal wetland, our salt marsh. And these are horseshoe crabs, an animal that I studied while I was an undergraduate at Hofstra University. They're very important animals. They've been relatively unchanged since way before the dinosaurs, and they're actually very cool. So our new building is something that we're looking forward to. It's going to be a LEED certified building. That just means that it's built with a very sustainable mindset. What we do when we have a sustainable building is we try to incorporate different materials that use less energy. So we have more natural glass to sort of warm our spaces using sunlight instead of actual furnaces. That cuts down our carbon emissions, our impact on the environment. And the new building will actually have a system to recycle rainwater. And that's going to be very important when we do our classes on water ecology. We do that for our older high school students, and we actually do water quality tests. So it will be really interesting to have a building that actually makes its own fresh water. That is going to be very useful in the future. So come check us out in the Northern Boulevard location. It won't be the exact same address as it was in the past, but we'll be sure to update that address shortly when we move in, so you guys can check us out there. And this is just going to be a couple of our classrooms. It's going to have a nice open space of the salt marsh and our trails nearby, and everything has been re-envisioned. This is a multi-million dollar grant that we finally got to make this happen. It took many years, and we're really excited that it's finally coming to fruition. So at Alley Pond, we don't only cater to people wanting to hike our trails and learn about the environment, but we also have animals in our care constantly. We have, at least the last time I saw the figure, we have over 80 different animals in our care. Although if you're talking about cockroaches, we actually have Madagascar hissing cockroaches, not the invasive pest kind. We have over 100 of those, so that alone. These are a couple of our different animals, some of which we're actually going to get a chance to meet in just a short while. So we have ringneck doves, we have chinchillas. These are both foreign species. This kind of bird is native to Africa. These are native to South America. These are native to Afghanistan. These are our leopard geckos. These are, again, a South American rodent that we call guinea pigs, and you guys can see them at pet stores, and they even appear on menus in Ecuador. People eat them. And this over here is a parrot called a monk parrot, and his name is Boone. He's one of my personal favorites. He's a sweetheart to me and one of the other educators, and basically hates everybody else. Can't figure out why that is. I think it's because I let him play with my name tag one time, and he decided that I was cool. That's sometimes how it is. All of our animals have their own personalities, and it's really cute to learn about them. This is Zelly, one of our bearded dragons, and she's gorgeous. We actually just got two new bearded dragons this week. And we're going to get a chance to meet one of them later. This over here is a ball python. This is one of our young ball pythons, a baby that was that we've been raising here named Solomon. This is a corn snake. This one is named Junior. And this is a northern bobwhite quail. And of course, over here we have a rabbit. So we have all of these different animals that we use for our programs. And we teach a lot of different programs using these animals. And the animals are taken care of daily. They're given lots of exercise, and they definitely enjoy hanging out with us. All right, next slide. All right. So my position at Alley Pond started in 2017. I was an educating docent, learning about how to actually teach environmental science to young children. And I found that I don't want to toot my own horn, but I have a knack for it. I really do enjoy teaching. And I create lesson plans. I engage with the students, do STEM activities, and cover different topics in the realm of environmental science. And I typically teach public and private schools, lead summer camp programs, scout groups, and birthday parties. So these are all different things that some of our educating staff do as well. We have a bunch of other incredible education staff, as well as all of our staff. I have to say, in terms of our staff, we got them. We got great people with us. And we all really are very close in terms of how we work together. And it's something that I haven't had the luxury of in my previous job. So I really do appreciate all that we do for each other and how supportive they all have been. It's really wonderful to have a family at Alley Pond. Just an overview of some of our classes. These are actually descriptions you can find on our website. This is our most popular program called Animals Alive. It's the most frequent one that we teach for our public schools. It's an interactive lesson where students understand animal classification. They understand the diet, habitat, and predator and prey relationships with animals. And this is one of our ringneck doves that I am holding in front of a student who seems to be very happy. Not all the students are excited about these animals. Sometimes they freak out a bit and you just have to gauge how they're feeling. If they want to touch the animals, they'll be into it. And I just say, if you don't want to, just say no thank you or look terrified and I'll know that you don't want to have anything to do with it. But I do enjoy teaching these students that we aren't the only animals on the planet. We do share our planet with more than just seagulls and pigeons. And the wildlife that we have around here isn't all there is. We have such a biodiverse world, and it's important that we sort of explore it. My personal favorite class that I teach is endangered species. It sometimes feels like a Debbie Downer to be talking about how animals are going extinct, but at the same time, it's a vital class because it really does focus on what it is that we can be doing better. Whether that is taking a shorter shower, turning off the light when you leave a room, carpooling. These are all things that have worldwide impacts, especially because of how many people there are today. We want to minimize our role in contributing to species decline, because we're actually in the sixth mass extinction right now. So I took a picture over here. This picture is showing something called coral bleaching. When we have lots of cars burning fossil fuels or smokestacks that sort of blow out carbon dioxide, that carbon doesn't just stay in the air. It comes back down in the form of acid rain, and it changes the balance of acidity in the ocean. And when the ocean becomes more acidic, you actually end up stressing out coral, and it starts to get rid of the algae that it has a relationship with to help it grow. And if it doesn't gain the algae back soon after, or if it keeps on expelling the algae because it's getting stressed out, it'll die altogether. And it forms this white looking coral, which is bleached, and that could kill an entire reef. And reefs are one of the most biodiverse ecosystems on the planet. So it's really important to keep them healthy. Another class that we teach here is about Native Americans. I mentioned that the Matinacoc people have been here for thousands of years. And they use this area right where I'm teaching now. They could have had a settlement. We actually find remnants of Matinacoc peoples in our park on our nature trails, believe it or not, especially in the northern nature area where we had our previous center. We would have discarded shells that were either used to make wampum, or they would use them as a food source. They would eat them, and then they would discard the shells in dump piles. And the discarded piles of shells are referred to as midden. So we have lots of midden in our park. And there are other artifacts that have been found in Alley Pond Park because they've been in this area very recently. Recently, off of Little Neck, near Little Neck Parkway, near Northern Boulevard, they now have a street named Matinacoc Way as well to pay homage to them. It's kind of sad. A lot of their records were actually destroyed in a fire that happened in a very in an older library. So they actually struggle with ownership rights to land, and that's something that we've been learning about recently in our class about Native Americans. Another class that we teach here for older students is our field biology internship. It's really great. It's for high school students. It's very selective. Not many students get into this program, but it's really impressive. What they end up doing is they go out into our park, into the neighboring waters, and they do what you see here. This is called seining, and they drop a net in and catch different small invertebrates, maybe small fish, and they take a sort of survey of the native and non-native animals in our park, which helps us understand the ecosystem. How are things sort of woven together? What does the food web look like? And sometimes you can even see how healthy the environment is by looking at certain species. So this is something that we have our students doing. It's really amazing to have them do that kind of stuff. And this is what High and Joan Rosner really would have appreciated and really would have been proud of us to be doing these kinds of classes. And it doesn't just stop there. We do other kinds of community service, such as our park cleanups. This over here is my boss. She's awesome. This is Rosemary. She actually used to teach the summer camp, and this is the Alley Pond Pioneer Summer Camp several years ago at our previous nature center. And they had just completed a park cleanup where you could see they have bags of trash. When I do park cleanups here, I like to make it a sort of race to see who can gather the most trash and which bag of trash weighs the most. And then the first prize gets some sort of gift or something like that. We try to help by cleaning up our beautiful park. We also do beach cleanups on Joe Michael's Mile, the field biology internship, which I explained a bit about. We had a BioBlitz, which is one of the colleges came to our area when I first started working here and did a really comprehensive survey of our flora and fauna as well. And we do festivals and outreach programs. The Douglas and Winter Festival takes place right by their train station every winter, and that's always a fun time. And then the Billy and Oyster Project is something that takes place in the north area of our nature center, where our previous nature center was located. We have a scenic dock that overlooks our salt marsh, and we have traps that contain oysters. And you'd think, why are we trapping the oysters? Well, actually, it's to protect the oysters. We want to make sure that the oysters are not going to get eaten by anything. This area was historically very prominently known for having large abundance of shellfish. So by putting oysters back in the ecosystem, they do their primary function, which is to clean water. A single oyster can clean 50 gallons of water a day. And they do that by filter feeding. So they take out pollutants and they make the water more habitable for other animals. So by having them in our harbor, by having them in our wetlands, they're really going to be doing a great job. So maybe we can continue our partnership with the Billy and Oyster Project. Definitely check them out. They're great. All right. So what I'm going to do next is I am going to segue into our live animal portion, where we're going to get a chance to meet several of the creatures that we have at our nature center. This is going to be something that we definitely want to show the kids. So let's go ahead and meet a couple of our animals. The first animal that we're going to meet is an animal that you could see very close by in our park. So it's going to be a native mammal. Mammals are animals that have fur on their bodies. They're warm-blooded, which means that their body temperature inside is sort of stable. And it doesn't matter how cold it gets outside, on the inside of your body, you're keeping yourself warm. That would be different to, say, a reptile or even a fish, which sort of depends on what the external temperature is to keep themselves warm or cold. So another thing that makes a mammal special and unique is that we give birth to live young, except for platypus and echidna, which do make eggs. We call those mammals monotremes. And mammals also feed their young milk, which is great because mom doesn't have to leave the babies defenseless to feed them. So by having milk on hand, it really does help with keeping your children safer for longer. And we're going to go ahead and meet our first animal. I'm going to go ahead and bring out. This is our first creature of the day. We keep them in these animal carriers. Just bear with me. Here we go. So this is the animal that was on the very front of our slideshow. This is Quinn. Quinn is a domestic rabbit. So let me see if you guys can look over here and see Quinn's big eyes. All right. So a domestic rabbit and a wild rabbit share a lot of similarities. They have a very similar body shape. They're nearly identical in terms of their DNA. The major differences are really in their behavior. Wild rabbits would never let somebody pick them up. They're very skittish. Domestic rabbits are much more calm around humans. Quinn here is one of our most popular animal ambassadors. At least I try to take him wherever I can. He's very friendly to the kids. He's a very calm rabbit as well. He has a very similar coloration to the wild rabbits that we have in our nature center, around our nature center. They would look like this. So you can actually see the similarity between Quinn and the native cottontail rabbit. Now, cottontails are actually a species of special concern because they have to deal with certain amounts of habitat loss. That has sort of affected their population size. So they're not endangered, but they are monitored. And their population is something that we are making sure that it doesn't decrease too much. So rabbits like Quinn over here have a couple of amazing tricks up their sleeve just to survive the day. Rabbits are an herbivore, and they're also a prey animal for a lot of different creatures out there in the forest, especially foxes. And if you guys actually want to go ahead and leave a comment, does anybody have any comment of another animal that might want to eat a rabbit? I want to let you guys get a chance to say something if you want. I've been talking nonstop. So I mentioned foxes. Anybody else have another animal that you think rabbits would have to worry about? It's okay. So another rabbit predator would be an animal like hawks, eagles. We actually now have bald eagles back in our nature, back in our park. There is a bald eagle that has a nest just over the border into Nassau County. I guess they found good real estate. And having bald eagles back is great news for the health of the ecosystem, but it's bad news for the rabbits because they are on the menu for eagles for sure. So major birds of prey like eagles would definitely try to eat a rabbit like this. And baby rabbits can also get eaten by snakes. So where they're most safe and most comfortable is underground, because that way they don't have to deal with birds of prey or even animals like foxes. Most of the time underground, they can escape their dangerous predators. But there's no food down there, so they do have to venture outside and get grass, which is their favorite food. So people think rabbits love to eat carrots, and that would be saying like humans love to eat chocolate. Yes, it's true. We love to eat chocolate. Maybe I eat it more than others, but we definitely can't live off of it. Carrots are very high in sugar for rabbits, so if it was the only thing that they were eating, they would actually get pretty sick. So we give Quinn here a diet of alfalfa and hay, and that keeps him pretty happy, and they also have some extra rabbit pellets that supplement their diet. So Quinn here is built for survival. Even though he's like nature's pizza, which is something I love saying, he is going to be able to outrun many of his predators. They can run faster than a human when they're full out sprinting. And because they have such big feet, some rabbits are actually even known to outrun avalanches by running on top of them with their very large feet. So that's pretty impressive for an animal that's this size. Not only are they fast runners, but they're also very capable jumpers. At our nature center, you can actually come in and see how far different animals jump, and you can test to see how far you jump. So that's a little exhibit you guys can check out when you come to Alley Pond. So Quinn over here is a great runner, great jumper. He has pretty good camouflage for the area nearby. And if we look back at the eastern cottontail rabbit, look at that camouflage. You would probably never even notice that he was right there. So these animals are built to basically not catch the attention of predators. And to also know if a predator is nearby, they're going to be constantly sniffing and smelling to make sure that none of you guys are a fox in disguise. So he's going to be smelling you guys. He's smelling the camera here. Wants to make sure that he's nice and safe. And he's pretty comfortable. So that's pretty good. They also have really large eyes on the sides of their head so they can see when predators approach. and their ears are cup-shaped to make use of every available vibration. Every sound will funnel into their ear that they can. So they actually have an incredible sense of hearing as well. All right. So what I'm going to do now is I want to show you guys a bit about our friend here, how he uses his fur in the winter. So rabbits have a thick fur coat. Like other mammals, they have hair. He has fur, which means it covers his whole body. When a rabbit is going to go outside in the wintertime, they actually need a thicker coat than they would have in the summer. So right now, some of his hair, well, most of his hair, he has his winter coat right now. But in the fall and in the spring, it's time to switch coats. They either get a more or less dense coat of fur, and it comes out in huge amounts. So I can actually see over here, there is sort of a black dot. I'm going to point to it over here. This area is of very thick hair that's ready to fall out. So I can gently, I'm not even touching very much. You can see that hair is coming really out of this area. So rabbits do shed quite a lot. Yeah, look at all that hair. Another cool trick that rabbits have, and even wild rabbits, is that most of the time their tail is white, or at least the bottom of it is white. Now, the reason for having a white tail or a white part of their butt is so when they're fleeing a predator, that white tail flashes up and down and kind of confuses the predator. At least that's what I've heard. That little bit of flashing is just distracting enough to throw a predator off balance. And when you're chasing an animal for dinner, you need all of your balance. You need to completely be present and you need to be on the hunt. So these are just a couple of little tricks that rabbits have to stay alive. Next, what I'm going to do, I'm going to see if there's room over here on my table to actually put Quinn down. And we can give him some hay that he'll eat. I'm going to move the camera. Hey, Quinn. So Quinn's, okay, he's typing on the keyboard. Hold on. See, I didn't really think this part through. How you guys can tell. All right. Quinn, chow time. So right now he's kind of freaked out. I just moved him. But when his ears go up like this, it means that he's much calmer. Can you not type on the computer? Come on, bud. I have food right for you. I know how much you love to eat. Quinn's actually been on a diet recently, so I thought he'd be really excited about all this food I gave him. Here I go, bud. No? You're just going to make me look like a fool in front of all my friends and family? Okay, fine. Do that. Oh, and now he's going to take a drink of my water. Okay. Quinn, thank you very much for our guest spot and our guest appearance on the show. Let's move forward. All right. So say goodbye, Quinn.
Bye, Quinn.
No, I said to the other people. All right. Let's go ahead and do the next animal. Oh my God, I'm covered in fur. Look at my hand. That's part of working here. Every day, covered in fur. I don't know if you guys can see that, how well that comes off on the computer, but definitely I'm covered in hair from head to toe now. So maybe I also have fur. Okay. Next, I want to show us an animal that is actually a predator of animals like rabbits. So I am going to be showing you next a snake. Snakes are a reptile. Reptiles are not mammals. Reptiles actually split off of where mammals were about the time right before the dinosaurs in what we call the Permian era. And this over here, I have a couple of pictures of snakes. There are two major groups of snakes out there. There are what we call venom. Well, they're, to call them groups isn't exactly true, but there are two different ways that snakes attack their prey. Snakes either will use what we call venom, or they will use what we call constriction. Today we're going to meet a constrictor. I don't know if you guys knew this, but it's actually illegal to own a venomous snake in New York City. So this over here is the most venomous snake in the world. It's called the inland taipan, and it is also known as the fierce snake. It's the most potent venom of any snake, and one bite can actually spell the doom for 150 people. They're found in Australia, not here in America, and they are just one of the venomous snakes out there. Snakes are incredible animals. Some of them have amazing camouflage. This over here is the Gaboon viper. I want to see if you guys can actually even see the snake in this picture here. It's very difficult to spot. Having camouflage like this gets a snake makes a snake have the ability to get very close to their prey without their prey even noticing that they were there. So they just wait in ambush for prey to come to them, which is really awesome. And in case you guys didn't see it, I'll highlight its head is over here, and the body goes down this way. And that would be another venomous snake. The snake that we're going to meet today is what we call a corn snake. So I'm going to bring out our friend Chi-Chi, who is one of our corn snakes here. She is a mother to one of our other snakes that we have here named Junior. So here she is. Oh, she's beautiful. Oh, she is just the most beautiful snake. She has gorgeous red colors, really beautiful, and yellow too. So the reason that they get the name corn snake is actually pretty cool. They get the name corn snake because not only do they, she's gonna climb up my face. Not only do they share a lot of similarities superficially that make them look like Native American corn. So here's a piece of maize or corn. This is a yellow piece, and here I have the red variety of maize. They come in these different colors. You can tell that, well, at least with some of the other snakes, they look very, very similar to the texture and color of Native American corn. That was because the people that would have been growing corn here, the Native Americans growing corn nearby, would have actually encouraged snakes to live near their cornfield. The snakes would get rid of the mice that were eating their crops, the pests, and as a result, there would be more harvest left over for the farmers. So because we had this almost symbiotic relationship with these corn snakes for so many years, they have taken a liking to humans. They're very docile around us. At least that's my theory as to why they're so comfortable around people. And that's one of the reasons why young amateur snake owners could start with a snake like a corn snake because of how friendly they are. This one's name is Chi-Chi. You can actually see how she's sticking out her tongue. Snakes have different kinds of senses than humans do. They can actually smell using their tongue, which they stick out of their mouth. So every time she sticks out her tongue to smell you guys, she's actually taking odor molecules into the back of her mouth and sensing what is nearby. So if she wants to, say, follow the smell of a dead mouse, whichever side of her tongue has more of that smell on it, she'll follow that scent trail back to where its origin was. So what I like to tell kids is if you farted in an elevator full of snakes, they would look at you right away because they know where the smells come from and you can't get away with it. Snakes are really awesome. Not only do they have that weird sort of sense with their smell, but some snakes actually have facial pits that can sense the heat given off by mammals. Corn snakes don't have those pits, but we have ball pythons here at Alley Pond Environmental Center that have those pits, and that allows them to hunt even in complete darkness. This is a tree-dwelling snake, so they're very comfortable wrapping their body in a small knot like this to keep them nice and steady on a tree branch, or in this case, my arm. So if I swung my arm back and forth like a branch in the breeze, this snake wouldn't have any problem holding on. Snakes are incredibly muscular, and people think that they don't have any bones, but they do have bones in their body. They have their backbone, just like you have a backbone. They were evolved from animals just like lizards. About the time of the dinosaurs, they diverged from the lizard group. And in some snake species, you can even see small scales that almost look like feet. So it's pretty awesome to see that they aren't completely, they don't have limbs anymore. But at one point they did. Now, they're great climbers. They use their belly scales to grab onto different surfaces. And those big scales there are called scooches. And each one of them has a separate muscle that can drag it along and push it So it helps give it a better surface area to grab onto things and move. So if I put our friend Chi-Chi down, which I'm going to do right now, I've just decided. All right, let's do that. All right, let's take that out of there. So if I put Chi-Chi down on the table, the first thing you'll notice is that she has to flip over. She has to put her belly down. She can't move with her belly not on the floor because that's where her scooches are. So if you take her and do some different things, you'll actually see she's able to only move with her belly scales. Now, she ate yesterday. Our snakes eat once a week. So they are going to be fed a mouse every Friday, sometimes more than one. But that's actually normal for reptiles. They don't have the metabolism that mammals have, so they don't need as many meals in a week that we would need. They don't need the three meals a day that we have. And some snakes eat once every month, or maybe even less than that, because their metabolism is so slow, they don't have to put energy into making body heat. All right. That is an awesome animal. Does anybody have any questions at all about Alley Pond, about corn snakes, about rabbits? So I do have one last animal I wanted to show us as a little bonus before I was signing off. Corn snakes, by the way, you can actually find them locally, not super local, but in terms of in the grander scheme of things, they do live quite locally. You can actually find them as nearby as New Jersey. So that's kind of fun. And once again, they're non-venomous species of snakes. Now, this animal has something in common with the next animal that we're going to meet. They're both reptiles. And because they're both reptiles, they have a couple of things that they would do in terms of their lifestyle that's very similar. So one thing that corn snakes do is they give birth to babies that are encapsulated in eggs. That's the same as this next animal. And corn snakes also shed their skin, which is something that they have to do as they grow up because their skin, their scales, can't expand as they grow. So they have to bust out of that and grow a new pair, grow a new scale underneath it. And that's why in all the cages that we, all of our enclosures that we have the animals in for our snakes, we include rough materials that they can start the process by scraping their scales off. So we have either it's bones or rocks or things like that. The snakes can sort of scuff their old scales off. Awesome. All right. Thank you for joining. Let's go ahead and meet the last animal. All right. Bye, Chi-Chi. I love snakes. I think they are beautiful. They feel, their texture is nearly that of what you'd expect a plastic toy to feel like. It doesn't feel slimy to the touch, and they're actually very graceful when they move around. All right, I put the snake in a bag like this, a cloth bag. That's completely normal in terms of how people would professionally handle snakes is that they put them in cloth bags like this. They can breathe through it the same way you would breathe through your mask, and that's totally fine for them. Actually, it's safer for them than the alternative to putting them in one of these animal carriers with all these holes in them, they could get stuck. Here's the last animal of the day. Hi there. Hi there. This over here is a bearded dragon. They're native to Australia. And if you guys look at the coloration on their body, any ideas where they can be found? Look at the camouflage that they would have. And think to yourself, because no one's typing this. No one's typing anything to me, at least. Oh, wait. Oh, people have been typing things to me. There are comments. I'm so sorry. How long is a corn snake as an adult? That was from my grandfather. Corn snakes can reach about, I want to say, like 5 feet long. I'm not 100% certain, but they're not a very large snake species, that's for sure. They can get long to a certain point, but they're nothing like what you would see for a reticulated python, or a Burmese python, which are some of the largest snakes. And the anaconda is the heaviest snake, but not the longest. And those guys can get up to 33 feet is the world record for a snake. People are having a hard time with this chat feature. Okay, sorry about that. Someone asked about the history of the old wooden docks near Little Neck Bridge, and I have no idea. That's okay. Sorry about that. I wish I had the answer. So let's go back to our friend over here. Okay. At least now I know that you guys have been leaving remarks. Good. I want you guys to think a bit about the camouflage of this animal. And if you have thought about it and you've come up with the idea that it lives in a desert environment, you would be correct. They primarily live in the outback desert, which is super red in terms of their sand. So you have these red colors on bearded dragons. And they're a very common pet that people own. In fact, my cousin owns a bearded dragon, and we have a bunch of them here. We just got this guy last week. He's a very new member of the Apic family. So welcome to our family. And I hope you guys deal with all of our crazy shenanigans. But they are incredible animals. They have a couple of really cool survival tools. When they are sort of trying to defend their territory, they puff up their beard, they puff up their cheeks and their chin, they flatten it out and it turns black, which is a sign of their aggressive intentions. And it's their way of saying back off. And if that doesn't work, they'll also do a little push-up display that looks sort of like this. And by doing this sort of weird movement, it's their way of saying, I'm big, I'm healthy, I'm strong. This is my territory, butt out. So that is pretty awesome. They also have these spikes on the sides that are meant to deter predators like snakes from trying to eat them. They just are discouraging because who wants to eat something that's spiky when there are less spiky options on the menu. Another awesome thing about these guys is that they have their tail. When they're trying to balance themselves, they use their tail. So if I just gently move him to this side, sometimes they take their tail and fling it around in circles, and that helps them to balance. But there's a time when their tail isn't needed. If they are in a life or death situation, they can actually take their tail off. Not all lizards can grow their tails back. Some can. Bearded dragons don't have that ability. In fact, you see over here on our new bearded dragon's tail, part of the end is missing. And that's because he got into a fight when he was younger with probably another bearded dragon from the person we who gave us this lizard. Right now is pretty common behavior, just flattening out onto a branch or something like that. They would be doing this to sort of sunbathe and get additional heat. Right now, this guy is soaking up the heat from my arm, and that'll be where he's most comfortable. These guys can actually use a third eye when they're trying to find a space to heat up or cool down. It's called their parietal eye, and it's right over here. It's nearly impossible to show you guys. I don't know how good the camera is and if it'll see that, but let me get something sharp that I can sort of point to it with. So it's a scale. Let me get this just right, lined up okay. All right, so the scale is right over here. It's a bluish looking scale. It doesn't look much different than the rest of the scales on his head, but it's sensitive to light and dark and can also detect where there's a nice shady spot to cool off. I don't know why they need a third eye to do that, but hey, you know what? If it ain't broke, don't fix it. That's sort of the mentality when it comes to evolution. Evolution isn't goal-oriented. So these guys are pretty cool. They do get larger than this. This is still a young one. And you could expect it to nearly double or maybe even triple in size when it's fully grown. So that's pretty awesome. They do have really sharp claws they use to grab onto trees so they can get out of the way of danger. And they are super cool animals. We feed our bearded dragons here worms called waxworms and several other bug species, as well as some fruits, but mostly vegetables like lettuce. We sometimes add calcium powder to help them with their scales and their bone growth. And that's something that reptiles really can't get enough of. So this is all really awesome. Great job, bud. Thank you for joining us today. If anybody has any questions, I'll be on for another couple of minutes. I want to draw your attention back to the PowerPoint presentation just for one last picture, just for one last slide, please. The reason that we're showing this last slide is to highlight our website. Right now, we are celebrating the 50th anniversary of our institution, which is awesome. And because we do so much to give back to the environment, it would really help us if you could support our Nature Center by donating or becoming a member. All the money goes back into our classes, back into helping take care of the animals here. And we really appreciate all of the support that we get from our patrons. That being said, come check us out online. You can sign up for our classes. I happen to be teaching a class on chocolate science tomorrow. So you never know what we're gonna offer, whether it's a class on how to be a vet when you're older, or an adult walk in the park with actual birders who go on tours and show people the native wildlife in our landscape. There's so much to do at Alley Pond Environmental Center. So check us out, and thank you all for joining me today.
Thank you, Jacob. And another big thank you to the Newtown Creek Environmental Benefit Fund, administered by City Parks Foundation and funded by the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. Please like and share this video, as this event will be available for viewing after. In addition, subscribe to the QPL channel to get more updates on similar upcoming programs. Links for replays of upcoming events, replays of past events, or more links related to the Hunters Point Environmental Education Center are in the live chat. Let me see if there's any questions. Just thank you for a wonderful presentation. So I hope to see everyone on February 12th at 2 p.m. The plant how microbes are intertwined with agriculture, food, and soil. Thank you again.
That sounds really
good. Goodbye. Cool. Take care.